If you look at these iconic intellectuals, they die young. They are called rebels with a cause. One of them was Steve Bantu Biko, who once said, the most powerful weapon in the hands of the oppressor is the mind of the oppressed. Yeah. I think that was one. They followed by Frantz Fanon, again, another rebel without a cause. No, a rebel with a cause. Who also one day mentioned that the people are their own liberators. And another one that was Amilcar Cabral. People don't quote Amilcar Cabral. I know President Thabo Mbeki quoted him in the famous quotation that says, tell no lies and claim no easy victories. But Amilcar Cabral, as if from the context, he was speaking on the eve of his party going to rule. He said, people have got eyes. They will look at you. They will not ask you certain things, but they will still question you in their minds. But one day they will decide. He said, don't lie. If 10 oxen go to a field and 2 had worked or pulled and 8 did not work, say only 2 were working, not only 10 were working. That was Amilcar Cabral. Going back to Ubiko, a rebel with a cause, he predicted his death actually at the age of 20. Why? Because he said people don't want to listen, and therefore will die one day. I'm coming back to Uzwelinzi, another rebel with a cause. If you look at Zwelibanzi's life, his father, Jongo Mhlanga, one of the turning points of the conference of the ANC was Kabwe, when he spoke there, ethetha ngesiXhosa, etolikelwa nguNyelenzi Charles Nqakula in 1985. The young boy Lekhaya comes from Kakulama as a soldier of Mkhonto Wesizwe. But there's something about the name Lekhaya which is prophetic. There was a cry for him to come back home, which I happen to actually have the freedom fighter myself been part of that cry. And he eventually came back home. Post-liberation, there's another cry for him to come back home. Is it not a very interesting coincidence? Now coming back home from prison. Again, having served with the king in 1994, when uPremier Lapa is saying uBaba Mhlaba, I think at that age, uKing Salingana, he was also my neighbor by Bishop. I happened actually to have been staying in the same constituency, King Street, Pycon, in 1994. I'm happy that I can see Mike Pasop, who's here, was also with the king. If people remember, there was a law that was discussed that time called Traditional Leaders Bill that was introducing the House of Traditional Leaders. So then basically there was a caucus of the ANC here and was sitting. Mike Pasop and other people. Kwa makuthethe leyo nanga umuntu oyazi king yo yeza ibeka lo mcimbi. Then kukhona oba uthonjeni abasethonje. Hayi simcimbi wethu lo. But what surprised all of us is when the band stood up. He was actually opposed to the House of Translators Bill. And the reason for his opposing this, they were very interesting. People never, you know, underline. I mean, remember, Prakooks was sitting next to me, he said, Habu. He said, I'm opposed to this because it's actually a fundamental contradiction in an African society that you are taking chiefs and inkosi from the people to parliament so that they must ask for funding from their subjects. And therefore, bazocela imali to their very same subject that they're supposed to rule. This is a fundamental contradiction. Isukaphi le nto? He even said, and yeah, nam le nto ndiyithethe. And those who sat up, and he virtually didn't stay. I remember Mathieu Boyd, I worked like Kali Parliament, and oh, But he exposed that for a fundamental contradiction that is embedded in our own constitution. Why taking, why House of Russia leaders? It is a contradiction in itself because for them to ask for funding, they must go to Treasury. How are they going to be respected? And he was posing a very fundamental question. One day, in the Scientific Research Council, he asked another, you know, rebel, a rebel with a cause. Another fundamental question. Uthi kume emthembu, le nto yenzeka phaa kwaZulu, kuthiwa kumkhosi womhlanga, kuthiwa abo omama okanye usisi banxiba okanye funeke behambe phambi kwabantu lahlobo bamangalo, you know, and exposing themselves. Uthi, is that African culture? I never thought about this. He said, by the way, that's not African culture, that's slavery. That actually came as a result. During the time of slavery, they were actually making our people to parade generals in front of them. That is why Abelungu, they will never reveal the parts that our people must reveal in the public. Is this African culture? Ivelaphi? I left thinking, is this African culture? Where does it come from? A question from an organic intellectual. One writer, Edward Singh, he once defined the difference between organic intellectuals and academics. He said, academics are those people who are likely to do one thing at the same every day, like certificated people, principals, nurses, professionals, doctors. But he said, the organic intellectuals are intellectuals on the move. They ask uncomfortable questions. They probe. They always probe against the establishment. As what the Fizmas Fall generation had done. As Frantz Fanon once said, each and every generation has a mission to fulfill. That mission is either fulfilled or betrayed on conditions of obscurity. I'm going back now. That's one, before I sit down, probe as the rebels, a rebel with a cause. The last, a quotation that I want to share was actually on the 2nd of February 1835, in addressing British Parliament, Lord Macaulay said, I quote, that was in 1835, I have traveled across the length and breadth of Africa, and I have not seen one person. I have not seen one person who is a beggar, who is a thief. Such wealth I've seen in this country, such high moral values, people of such caliber, that I do not think we should ever conquer, or we would ever conquer this country, unless we break the very backbone of cultural heritage. And therefore, I propose that we replace her old and ancient education system, her culture. For if the Africans think that all that is foreign and English is good and greater than their own, they will lose their self-esteem, their native culture, and they will become what we want them to be, a truly dominated nation. Close quote. Now, this must be where we start and develop our discussion. This statement was made on the 2nd of February, 1835. What followed then was the destruction of our value systems, our education, cultural heritage, and so on. Our indigenous laws were relegated and only applied insofar as they were not viewed as in conflict with European law. I'm a product of Roman Dutch law myself. When Professor Mkrege taught us what was called African law, there was a part where I'll never forget that said, African traditions will only be accepted if they're not contrary to good morals. Contra bonos mores principle. I can see students here. Introduction to law. I'm closing actually by probing this, because this quotation actually by this person, it followed, and you know, many, even Cecil John Rhodes once said, if a native wake up tomorrow and think that is an English, must have won lotto. That's a quotation. Now, traditional institutions were undermined, infiltrated, and made accountable to the European authorities. Now, the Black Administrative or Administration Act of 1927, you cannot not talk about that, was a climax in the destruction of traditional leadership. Those chief who resisted the European rule were charged, arrested, and even punished. Puppet chiefs were appointed, and a new categories of traditional leadership, namely headmen, were introduced. This led to disunity in communities, families, and households. It was during these times that our value systems, which include tradition, culture, and other practices, were eroded. Languages were seen to be inferior, were also destroyed. As I'm closing, actually, I'm going back to Meek, who said, who did this? All the years, it was not only whites. Whites introduced it. But the most powerful mind, the most powerful weapon in the hands of that oppressor is a black person. Because why is our traditional wisdoms being actually defended by the majority, which is black people against other black people? It's what Sibiko mentioned. I'm interested in what Nadel, for example, talking to Nadel, these young lawyers, they are challenging customary marriages, its application. That's Roman Dutch law. Indoda isweleka noba ibingasathethi nomfazi inyeminyaka elishumi Ngenxa ye certificate esisifubeni. Uyo decide ayibe indoda mayingcwatywe. And I'm looking at that case as emthatha ugqitywa decide. The case ayikwa thwa no. And people like they submitted and said that ikatumari law doesn't allow that to mend. Ebefike izolo. Maka decide ingcwatywa kule ndoda. Another funeral here, it was so painful that even abantwana bakowabo lo bhuti ebengcwatywa were not even mentioned in a funeral. Because it is the wife who must actually decide. Which law is that? There's a romantic law. There are many examples about this, which makes us that must actually prove. When it's also interesting in the case of Mamanomzam, Winnie Mandela. Again, which is another test of this tension between traditional, our customary law and our practices and the Western culture. So all of these actually call upon a need for, in much of the Constitution is so mentioned that it's progressive and so forth, but there are questions. As I'm sitting down, kuyabonakala ke into kubana ezinto ezi, this is that we must actually probe and probe and probe quite in a manner that will ensure that we decolonize African heritage. And that decolonization of African heritage, even in many things that we were saying, it is clear that using these other, you know, authors, these organic intellectuals that have spoken about, that there's another struggle that we must actually wage. And that struggle is a very, very difficult struggle. It's actually very complex, this one. Their struggle actually is not a physical struggle, it's a recolonization of the mind. Thank you.
Thank you.